Good evening, welcome to Ben TV. Today's Tuesday the 24th of May. And what you see here are people assembling for a historic occasion. Today the Victorian Government is offering an apology to Victorians convicted as criminals of engaging in homosexual activities. In the state of Victoria until 1981, gay men were arrested, convicted and even imprisoned for offences ranging from buggery to loitering for homosexual purposes. Often sexual abuse victims were charged with criminal offences. In 2014, the Victorian Government recognised the injustice dealt to hundreds of men who had job and travel restrictions placed on them because of their so-called criminal record, and legislated to erase the criminal records of men who were convicted in the past. Today is a formal apology for the injustice meted out to the gay community. It is indeed an historic occasion.
Well, I'm here today because in 2011, on Carnival Day, I lobbied the then member for Pran, Clem Newton Brown, to look at a method to remove historical gay sex crimes for men who were charged pre-1980. And Clem then worked through the Liberal Party and the government to produce a bill in 2014 that then expunged and extinguished historical gay sex crimes.
Clem, can you tell us why it's important to expunge the records of gay men who were convicted for homosexual crime?
Yeah, sure. Look, this is an issue which has been around for a long time, since decriminalisation back in the 1980. And Peter came to me at midsummer with Noel Tovey's book and said, you should read this, which I did, and was incredibly moved by it, and thought that this is wrong for these men to have the convictions that they've had hanging over them for so long. So I thought, well, this is a great symbolic opportunity for the government to show that it should never have been a crime. But in the course of working through it with Peter and with Corey Earlham, Anna Brown and others, it became apparent it wasn't just a symbolic gesture, it was actually something that impacted on people on a day-to-day basis in terms of their employment, volunteering, travel. So it then became a matter of urgency for me as the member for Paran to try to get this through before the end of the last Parliament. And I'm pleased to say that we did it just before I lost my seat, the last day of Parliament.
Well done. Tell us why an apology is now important. We've got the legislation through, so why is the symbolic apology actually happening?
Well, I think it's a recognition that what's gone on in the past was wrong, and also that we as a community are sorry for it. In this place here, 150 years ago, we enacted legislation which was wrong. We made a big mistake, and you know, we copied the British Parliament in enacting buggery laws, and it took well over 100 years for them to be extinguished, and then after that another 30 years for those convictions to be expunged. So I think today is about the final chapter, putting a line under it, and making a statement for the community, which obviously has flow-on effects for mental health issues as well.
Did you have a hard time getting it through the legislation system?
Well, no. I mean, from the will to do it was there from everybody in the Liberal coalition, and when it came before Parliament, it was a unanimous vote amongst all parties. The real issue, I think, was just having somebody to take it up as a cause and to navigate through the political process. So I found that speaking with all my colleagues, even the most conservative, they all thought it was a very good idea. And once I had that tacit approval, it was then just a matter of working through the process. And it's great today that Labor's instigated this apology because it highlights the bipartisan nature of it.
An apology to me is important because an apology is about having government's about having great relationships with people. And here's a group of people that were excluded from the process, and an apology is saying sorry, so that means the relationship can be restored. The second importance about the apology is that it helps promote that people who may have a criminal record because of an historical gay sex conviction can actually know that they can get that removed.
I'm here because I'm one of the first men in Victoria to have had my criminal records expunged under this new legislation. I believe there's three of us involved. And my conviction took place 54 years ago, and I've lived with that for all that time, and every now and again, three times importantly in my life, this criminal record caused me to lie. For example, when I applied to go to the USA as a tourist, the visa application asked, did you have a criminal record? I lied and said no. It wasn't picked up. I was convicted when I was 18 years of age, at which time I was an accounting student, and I studied part-time for 15 years to qualify as a chartered accountant. On finishing my examinations, I had to apply formally to the Institute of Chartered Accountants in Australia for membership. And on that application form, there's a question. Do you have a criminal record? If I'd answered honestly to that, I would not have been admitted. This is typical of what I've had to live with for 54 years. Now that my record has been expunged, I can honestly say I don't have a criminal record.
Can you go into any detail about why you were charged in the first place?
Why I was charged? I was charged because of very unjust laws in Victoria. What do you mean, the circumstances?
Yeah.
Right, I was having sex with another male in a car in Richmond Boulevard beside the Yarra one night when there were perhaps 20 vehicles parked there. At least one of them was gay. It was our vehicle, but there were probably 19 vehicles with heterosexual couples perhaps having sex or at least being away from the public. And a policeman shone a torch into our car and arrested us, took us to Richmond Police Station. We spent the night there. We were interrogated. They got two confessions out of me, not just for that night, but for an incident 2 weeks before that. And that was the beginning of the process. And that's where so I was an 18-year-old. Welcome to Victorian justice.
That would have been a truly horrifying experience. So it must have had an impact on your family and everything else at the time.
My family were very supportive. I came from a country farming background, and I must say my father was magic in his in assisting me. We didn't talk about it particularly, but he never judged me on that. What it did do, though, was it scared me off homosexual sex for, I think, 15 years, 14 years or something. I subsequently got married and divorced, not over my sexuality. In fact, recently I've met my ex-wife and she doesn't believe I'm gay, for what it's worth. But the terrifying experience of being in prison, in jail overnight, having to front the court 18 months later, it's terrifying.
Absolutely. Do you ever think a day like this would come when the whole ugly period was not expunged, but now you're being apologised to?
Unbelievable. The big issue, of course, was 35 years ago when the law was changed and decriminalised. That was a massive step. And that meant gay men, boys could live a freer, open life, but it didn't actually change my legal status. I've had that record was still there.
As an 18-year-old, would you have imagined a day today when not only homosexuality has been decriminalised, it's somewhat celebrated, but now we're now talking about marriage equality and marriage and equal rights for across the board?
No, I couldn't have imagined it. It's very hard to think of everything I thought of when I was 54 years ago. But I suppose most of it I associated with terror, right, for me. In other words, if I was caught doing anything, so I suppose I clearly sublimated it all, but the idea of imagining decriminalising, I mean, I was aware I was different. And today, I'm sure every young boy and girl who are gay or transgender are aware of the difference. And yes, we've made huge steps, but we shouldn't get too carried away with this. This morning I'm having coffee with a friend, and a friend of his, a business associate, arrived, and I was introduced to this man, and he came past this morning and saw the flag on Parliament House, and we sort of started saying this tirade of, you know, and what they want to do for poofters today, the whole thing, and my friend's actually sitting there totally embarrassed. I couldn't be bothered joining in the conversation, but we mustn't forget homophobia is still out there, right? And so's people who cannot respect or appreciate the difference of other people. So, I mean, this man is probably 60, 65, but, you know, it's not easy today even. It's better, but it's an ongoing fight. And I think this government and Andrews is to be commended for enabling this to happen.
Government will apologise for the unjust laws of the past and the harm they have caused for decades. We can't underestimate the human toll that these laws have taken on people such as Noel Tovey, Tom Anderson, Peter McEwan and Terry Kennedy. These laws have taken their toll and it's time that these wrongs were righted by the Victorian Government. The apology today will start to right these wrongs, but it also affirms our dignity as human beings. Today, there are young people, young gay and lesbian people around Australia struggling with their sexuality, and this apology will help ease the shame and stigma felt by these young people who are finding their place in the world.
First of all, I want to say that this is a really momentous day for me because I never thought that I would live to see this day in Australia. And I think it's also a very good day for every gay man because finally the government of Victoria is viewing us or seeing us as real human beings. And that's really important. When I was in jail, contemplating suicide, I never thought that I would actually get out of Pentridge alive. I went through a very bad time in, I made my debut at Her Majesty's Theatre in 1954, and the dancers, including the principal dancer, went to the English choreographer and said that they refused to work with me. And when she asked them why, they said I was a notorious homosexual, that I'd been in jail, and that I was Aboriginal. I learned many, many, many years later, at a reunion, I learned that she said to them, well, you can all leave if you want to. I can get more of you, but I can't get one more of him. And made me the understudy to the principal dancer. And many years later, when I was in the European premiere of O Calcutta, I made her my ballet mistress. So what goes around comes around. Thank you.
Back in 1977, when I was a victim of child abuse, when I worked for the police, as a 14-year-old, when I told my story to the police, I was also charged with three offences, one count of buggery and two counts of gross indecency. I then had to go before the Children's Court and plead guilty, apologise to the magistrate, and also promise never to do it again. Now, I was a naive 14-year-old. I could not comprehend or could not understand what was actually happening to me. At no time did I have legal representation, and back then, no time that I received any counselling. Yeah, I can remember the police telling my parents, don't worry, he won't need counselling, he'll get over it. I just lived with that secret. Yeah, it affected my relationships growing up and going through high school. I think I lived as a hermit without having the ability to actually make friendships or build friendships or maintain friendships. It also affected my relationships with others, and all my life I've had trust issues, especially when dealing with any matter of dealing with the police. Every time I had to go to a police, even when I was a victim of a burglary, when I went to the police and the police came to my place, I became that 14-year-old boy again. Back in 2010, I went public with my secret because every time I'd been and had counselling, the first question a counsellor or a therapist would ask me is, why did this happen to you? And I could never be able to answer that question. I couldn't comprehend why did this actually happen? Why did it have to happen? And it took me a long time to work out that I actually had done nothing wrong. I finally came to terms with that, probably only in the last 6 years, that I actually did do nothing wrong. But today for me is finally a public acknowledgement that I actually did nothing wrong. And to have that it's a big step in being able to put all this behind me and actually continue on with the rest of my life kind of thing. It's a culmination of a 6-year dream. I started back started off in 2010 hoping to get an apology. I was told back then that my dream was quite chaotic and, you know, I was aiming high, but I never gave up. I campaigned on my own for 2 years before using social media, and then through Anna Brown and the Human Rights Law Centre, they were able to pick up my case, pick up my campaign, and then champion my cause for the past 4 years. You know, and I can't acknowledge enough the support and the friendship that I've received from Anna Brown. You know, not just as my lawyer, but also as a friend. You know, checking on me, seeing how I'm doing, keeping me updated, and taking this further than I could ever take this myself. Yeah, I'm just very honoured and very proud to be able to be here today and actually hear this apology. Yeah, it's a pinnacle of the campaign, and it's going to be a high point of my life. Thank you very much.
I'm Peter McEwan. I just turned 17 in 1967 when I was arrested, and I really didn't know what was happening to me. And for about 4 years after that, I just shut down and was in a state of shock. So today means a lot to me. And, you know, 39 years later, I had the first conversation I've ever had with my older brother, who's on the steps with me today, about this, because it was never spoken about. And I have three sisters coming to see the apology. Our family never spoke about it, so it is a big thing. And it's also, I believe, important that every young girl and boy growing up today who feels different, the Parliament to say, you're okay, you're a good person. Thank you.
Well, I'm Jamie Gardner. I'm a long-time campaigner. In fact, I've been on this particular trail for just over 40 years. And I think this is an absolutely wonderful and important symbolic milestone on a long journey from persecution to protection. And indeed celebration. I've worked with people at every stage of this journey, from when gay men were all prima facie outlaws, to now when the state is about to make a formal apology to us for the laws that they, both sides of Parliament have acknowledged should never have existed. I think really that's the main thing to say. Those laws should never have existed. They were unjust. Those who suffered directly under them can now get their records expunged, treated as if they had never been, and protected against the prying eyes of even casual researchers, let alone people who gossiped about them years ago. But this apology is important for the whole state, because everyone was harmed by the prejudice that led to and was fueled by those laws. Not only the people who were convicted, but their relatives, their mothers, their fathers, their brothers and their sisters, their children or nieces and nephews, as we have seen in some of the comments on Daniel Andrews' Facebook posts, people who lost relatives to suicide as a result of these laws. Everyone in this society is damaged by prejudice, and this is a prejudice that has lived on in these records and is now being expunged where it's possible, where the people are still alive, or the people who can go for a posthumous expungement become aware of that. But it's everyone. The laws and their random, arbitrary enforcement back then amounted really to a campaign of terror. They terrorised the population, they terrorised gay men in particular, and lesbians, and our friends and families. To have a formal state apology in Parliament, as well as the legislation from 2014 from both sides of Parliament, to have a formal apology that the state acknowledges that these laws were wrong and regrets and says sorry, is a wonderful thing. And I congratulate the government and the Premier for their very real commitment to that apology, to genuinely saying sorry in full knowledge of what it means to us and all of us and for all of us.
Well, today we turn a new page in our state's history. Righting past wrongs and through the Premier's apology, striving towards equality for gay, lesbian and bisexual Victorians. For many years, gay and bisexual men and women have had to live with convictions for something that should never have been a crime. And today's apology is a sign that those times when we considered homosexuality a criminal offence are so far behind us now. This is an important step in the long journey towards equality for LGBTI Victorians, and hopefully an important step in the healing process for the men and women and their families that have been affected by these convictions. Today we can say that we live in a state that not only recognises its past mistakes, but embraces the people of diverse sexual orientations and gender identities that make up our community. So I say thank you. Thank you to the men who have had the courage to speak out. Thank you to the advocates who have fought for their cause. And thank you to the many politicians across the political chamber who will today say a long-awaited for sorry and close this dark chapter in our state's history.
It's impossible to overestimate the effect of the apology on these men in dealing with the hurt for their wrongful convictions. But I also think it's impossible to overestimate the symbolic importance of the Premier of our state on the House of Parliament, on the floor of Parliament, speaking on behalf of the Victorian population as a whole, apologising for these wrongs and for the hurt, and also the implication that the Premier is acknowledging the value and dignity of LGBTI people's lives. This apology does both. It addresses the harm, but it also is a public recognition of the value of LGBTI Victorians. And like all the other speakers, I really want to congratulate the government for taking this and making this a public apology. So thank you.
The Victorian AIDS Council came out of the gay and lesbian rights movement of the early 1980s, and today we congratulate the state government on this historic apology. We hope that this goes to repairing decades of persecution and shame experienced by gay men and lesbians in our community. For many, though, sadly, they're no longer with us. As we came out of criminalisation, we moved into an epidemic of the AIDS crisis, and many of the people who should be hearing today's apologies are no longer with us. So today is not just about repairing history, it's also about healing and about reflecting on the lives of the loved ones and the friends who are no longer with us today to hear this apology. Thank you.
How you feel?
Wow, sort of very moved, very emotional. We're all in this together. I'm not a gay man, but of course, I know we talk a lot about the differences within the rainbow, but today we're all in this, together, because it's really important. One of the few apologies to any or all of the LGBTI community anywhere in the world. So let's take it and enjoy it and acknowledge those who experience difficulty at the same time. Definitely.
Now, we know the legislation, the legislation was passed in 2014 that effectively expunged the record. But today's a symbolic gesture, it's a formal apology. How important for you is this apology?
Oh, look, it says that we are valued as part of society. We're valued for our diversity. We want to try to make up for the wrongs, and we're doing that. We're seeing now not just, legislation that decriminalises or gives us equal opportunity protection, but for social support. So it's part of both. I think you've got to have a balance of symbolic and practical today as part of that. And the fact also that it is cross-partisan in its support is really important. When the occasion happens, we can do it right, which is good too.
But we've got an occasion like today when we're being issued a formal apology for a vilification of an entire community.
Yeah.
But now we've got a plebiscite coming up that's going to discuss gay marriage, and which again throws the whole homosexual question into question again. Are we going two steps backwards, one step forward? Are we going two steps backward for one step forward?
It's a funny mix, isn't it? We have, let's be fair, a good state of affairs in Victoria, yet overall nationally at a federal level, it's not so good. And that's a hard paradox, I think, to live with. But, the fact that we have the positive, let's take that and use it as a strengthening means to work, do what we have to do federally. but I also think that that federal attitude is the last of a dying era, probably weighed down by some conservative states and territories as well.
And your prognosis for the gay and lesbian community going into the future?
I think for the rainbow community overall, it is good. People's attitudes are shifting. We've got this amazing thing called internet and social media where people communicate both for social and support and also for advocacy. I'm not the hugest technological person in the world. It amazes me that I can Skype with someone in French Guiana about our issues. And I think that's important because we then can save a bit of wheel reinvention, use each other's ideas to boost each other. I have hope. It's not, you know, we all know it's got to happen with effort, but if we make the effort, it will happen.
Well, it means that at the age of 80, I'm no longer a criminal in the eyes of the law or society.
And has that had an actual impact on your life in the way you've had in the past 80 years?
Well, no. I mean, I was arrested. I always used my father's surname. And then my mother, when I came out of jail, told me that I didn't have to any longer, that I was illegitimate. And my legal name was Tovey, so...
And so you got around doing that way. Okay. I saw Black Bastard a few years ago. It was a fantastic performance. So is there going to be a sequel now to that?
I've written the second volume of... it's called And Then I Found Me. That's the second volume of my autobiography. It deals a lot with my time in America during the Rockwell riots and Martin Luther King, that era particularly.
Could you tell us a little bit about the time when you were arrested, what the scene was like at the time and the parties and what life was like then?
Life then was very much closed. Gay men and lesbians and criminals in Melbourne here were a very tight group of people. And so parties were whispered. You didn't know who was hearing. And the police would often raid a party, a gay party. So what would happen would be you'd be invited to a party and when everyone arrived, the doors would be locked.
It actually reminds me very much of the scene in India just about 10 years ago when everything was quiet and everything existed in house parties. How has gay liberation or the change in the way that people have viewed homosexuality over the past few years? What do you think of the change? Has it been a very overwhelming positive change or any thoughts about it?
Well, I've got a lot of thoughts. I've been an activist all my life. I think the people and the government of the day are now realising that the LGBTI community, we're all humans. And... we should be treated equally.
A few years ago, I was working on a musical play that actually celebrated the Mattachine Society. But one of the songs in the musical was this lament about the times gone by when being gay was all supposedly very civilized and discreet and quiet and was all dependent on a raised eyebrow with a backyard scene at the opera. And so there's a certain sense of discretion about it. Which appeal to some people, but the fact we're all out now and proud, and so that sense of artifice is now lost in a way. Is that?
Well, it wasn't artifice. It was a reality. It was forced on people, particularly here in Melbourne. Like they could never have met like this, gay people. In fact, in my day, all these people would have been arrested. You would hear about a party or you'd have a certain way of dressing. There was a discreet sect. There was also a very strong class system amongst gays.
Much has changed, but today is truly a day to celebrate.
Yeah.
Congratulations to all of us.
Yeah.
And my personal congratulations to you for being a poster child for the massive change that should have occurred.
It's been great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.